evening. Talk to us for a few minutes about that evening of... Was it St. Patrick's evening in 1921?
21, yes. Well, before Headford Ambush, they were training over on the foot of the Pap Mountain for 2 weeks before Headford Ambush. And as you know, they were inside in a cave, it was just about the size of this room now. And they were there training, preparing that there was some loophole coming up that they were going to get arms, which they needed. There was no, they had no arms at all.
And yeah, the arms were very scarce in those years.
They were.
Now, we're speaking about was it a local column of volunteers?
You had all the, your different columns in coming in, like down to now, you had Tommy Max and John Allman and Jimmy Bailey, and they had the locals then. Yeah. They were there from Gortarrig, and all the names are here by me in the list.
I'd say the younger generation wouldn't know very, very much around the county about this. We're all kind of too young, and some of us weren't even born at all at the particular time back in 1921. Just to kind of refresh people, we were saying there that there was a lot of volunteers stuck for arms. There was no arms around, in fact, except for an ordinary old shotgun or something like that at the particular time. Artillery was the thing to have if one went to fight. Now, tell us about this train that was supposed to have gone from Killarney to Kenmare. What was the reason for that, first of all?
Well, they would take down goods down to Kenmare every week, do you understand?
Yeah.
They go a different day every week, the train, do you understand? And they travel on the trains. But this day, this Miss Tagney, to them, in the list, she got some result that...
she got a tip-off that
she did.
This train, this particular train was going to go to Kenmare that day,
right,
and return from Kenmare.
The following day.
Yeah. Now, just to speed things up a little bit, the local column here were supposed to hijack that train, weren't they, to get the arms?
Well, you see, the thing about it is you had the column over in Gortarrig, the name of the place. They was carried dispatches then from, we'll say, Kilgarvin to Gortarrig to Killarney and Skapti Glen and Corra. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, there was one fellow delivering the dispatch, and he'd give contact every group, do you understand? So when they found out that the train was coming up with the soldiers from Kenmare, they contacted all them, so they all got together then, and they joined at Headford.
Now, the thing where it went wrong, I suppose, if you could say that, in Headford, was that the train from Kenmare came too early.
That is true. Yeah. That's why Dan Allman, there was no need for anyone to be shot at Headford Ambush, because only Dan Allman was such a brave man that, you know, he never thought of the train coming up. And as it said there again, this Con Mahoney from Tralee, he was driving the train.
He was supposed to be a bit of a whiz kid and driving as well.
He
drove it too quick.
Too quick. Well, they weren't on duty at all when the train landed in. And Dan Allman called the roll in before that. And all the list of the, I hope we'll give the list of the men that fought there. Because, which is very important, because a lot of the youth wouldn't know who fought at Headford Ambush.
All right. I will read that list out, actually, after the commercial break, which is coming up in a minute's time or so. But first of all, before we go to that break, I want to talk to you again. I know that the late, we'll say, Tommy Mack, that was the grandfather now of the present Tommy Mack Jr. from Bellamy Kelligate. He was situated in the old station master's house out here.
He was. Well, you see, they had to guard the station master and the missus of the station as well, because so many of them guarded that station master's house.
Mm-hmm.
And the rest went on their duty, but Dan Allman was caught in the middle of it. The train had come too quick, and I know it was a Jim Coffey that was caught with him. They weren't in their positions at all when the train came on. And when the train stopped, two of the soldiers jumped out, going to the toilet. And they asked them to see with their cylinder, and they said no, and they shot him straight in.
Yeah, D.G. Allman and the Coffey men went to the toilet, first of all,
no,
was it?
Two English, the two British soldiers that went to the toilet.
And they were caught coming out, was it?
And they were caught. They asked them to surrender. The English soldiers didn't surrender. Of course, they thought they had 20 of them. They thought they were well secure, because they knew that the Irish, the local bunch, had much. That's how the only hope they had of getting arms and ammunition was to watch all those loopholes that was there, as smart as they were.
I want to take a quick break here, and when I come back to you, we'll talk about how they managed to get the guns, if they got them, and the ammunition from the train, or what went wrong there, in just a moment. Thank you.
Sean Hurley on 90.
He was dead, and he turned around to him and he said, "A glass of holy water in my pocket you will find. It's the only thing I brought from home which I left behind." He was just able to say a few words, But she was gone immediately.
Did anybody, though, manage to get the ammunition that was supposed to be on that particular train off of it?
Well, they collected all, they collected all the ammunition before the car train was supposed to be coming on, and they had to get their traps quick, and they collected their ammunition and what was there,
yeah.
Because there was 20 soldiers shot there.
Okay, that's another train you're talking about there. That was coming from Mallow that evening as well.
It had to be cleared out of the station before that train came on.
In that particular train, though, there was quite a lot of fusiliers as well. They had plenty of ammunition, I believe.
Well, the thing about it, if they hadn't gone out of the station, that would say within 20 minutes, the whole lot of those be shot, because as you know, when you were not used to use the guns that they had, you wouldn't do much good with them.
Did the locals then retreat?
They retreated for the mountain where they started. That's all near the foot of the mountain. To the place, as I said before, to the place called Koosh.
Who else around you can talk to me about this here?
Here and Jimmy Cronin.
Jimmy, how are you?
Not bad.
No. Jimmy, from what you heard,
what happened on that day? Because only for the way to the army people that saved all the doors, they were all shot. I'll tell you one story. My father was in Headford Ambush. And when they were training over in the mountain, he came down one night. They were there for 2 weeks. He was there for 10 days in here. And he came down one night to change his clothes. He was wet out. As you know, if we were inside in the mountain, something similar today or yesterday. But he came down to change his clothes in here. And as Jimmy said, they were all not mean. But he changed his clothes and went up to bed and slept for a couple of hours. And the next thing, the knock came at the door. And these two English soldiers came in. And they were inquiring, see where was he. One of them went upstairs, but my father was above in bed, and my grandmother, when she had the knock, she went up and lit up, and there was a ticks, all feather mattresses that came down the stand, and you'd be inside in a valley inside in the tick.
Yes.
But she lit up on top of them, and the two soldiers came up, and one of them searched all the rooms, and my grandmother lit on top of them, and he came up and he says to the other fellow, what are you looking for here? I'm going to leave the poor woman alone. So they went off. So that's, I'm lucky to be here tonight.
Well, the poor man must have been nearly smothered.
These great days for Ireland, as you'd say, because that's what we have, the freedom that those people fought for. That's why we have freedom today. If we were under English rule, which there were that time, you wouldn't have much freedom. We wouldn't be talking as loud tonight.
Let me talk about your dad once again. He survived that battle here in Headford. Was there many killed or injured from that group?
There was the thing about it, Dan Allman and young Jimmy Beardy, he was
two killed.
Yes.
Of about how many, 30 or something was it?
There was supposed to be 30. Yeah. Well, the twin in the song that was made up after them was 20. The one man I have to mention here, before I read out the names that all that fought here at Headford, was Denis Spillane. He was a teacher down here in Dunfermline. Because he kept the record, and that's why we have all the history of Headford Ambush to be all patched. I mean, it's fine for us to talk about it here now, but anything that was written down has stayed.
Okay.
So
it's fairly accurate?
It's very perfect. Perfect, yeah.
Okay, can I ask you another question now, seeing that day is gone? Was it all in vain that there were so many people hurt and killed and all that?
No, every one of those, they went out to fight for their country, because they knew when the treaty, any one of those wouldn't sign a treaty. And that's why that's why we have the freedom we have today all over those men. So that's why I'm delighted to Derry Healy bring this show here tonight, because Headford Ambush, there's more history in Headford Ambush than anywhere we travel in the county. And you had all the men above, Billy Mac, Tommy, the three, history of the three Macs, we'd say. Their grandfather took over from Dan Allman here the day of the Headford Ambush. And with his son, then he made out down there, and the three, and the present lad again. So that's history on itself.
Sure is. Yeah, sure is. Okay, thank you very much, and I'll be reading out those names who took part in a little while on the program as well.
The people that know that fought at Headford Ambush, I would like to you read out all those names.
Okay, I'll do that for you.
Yeah.
Thank you indeed. Give them a nice round of applause, please. Thank you. Dan Allman, Tommy McAllistrum, Jack Cronin, Moss Carmody, James Bailey and Jack Buck, Bally McKelly, Johnny O'Connor, Farmers Bridge, Tom Fleming, Corrow, Peter Brown, Scarta Glen,
Jack Shanahan, Dennis Prendable, Dave McCarthy and John Brosnan, Castle Island. Michael O'Leary, Farnham 4, Tom O'Connor, Scarthine, Kingmare. Dan O'Sullivan, Patsy, Morley's Bridge. Sean Flynn, Banan. Paddy Lynch, Kenmare. Pat O'Shea, Warrock. James Coffey, Beaufort. Tim Dunhue and Nealis McCarthy, Killarney. Dan Healy, Rockfield. James Daly, Kilquan. Michael Doherty, Lisnagrave. Giles Cooper, Drown. Con Cahill, Gert Darrig. Peter Sullivan, Artie Gallivan. Dinbat Cronin, Rabeg. John B. Linehan and Dennis Sullivan, Rathmore. Pat Cronin, John Carvin, Lynn Flisk. Those who fought at Headford Junction.
Oh, who is the youth with the dark curly hair? Who is kneeling and praying in that old Sudan chair? He sighs as he strikes his brave breast now and then. He is thinking of home, of his country and men. Then he jumps to his feet, there's a knock at the door. A youth steps inside and the message he bore. He hands it to Allman, who read it with joy, saying before the day's over, some Tommies will die. Then he called on his youth who has fleet as a deer. They are tightening their rifles and their bandoliers. Oh God, they are off. The old woman cries, God guide them and guard them and be by their side. With hearts ever true and their heads held up high, for God and old Ireland they're ready to die. Then down the brown heather, like children at play, and to Headford Junction they are making their way. The station is reached, they begin to prepare. The wagons are shifted, the place is made clear. The train is soon sighted, the boys disappear, the rifles are loaded and at the prepare. When the train reaches the station, the Tommies jump out, saying, where are those shinners we all hear about? But they hadn't to wait long, till a shower of lead rain came cracking and tearing from under the train. To get to the enemy, he must go to the rear. The cart train is coming, there is no time to spare. Then under the wagon, he seemed to go. He is kneeling and firing and lying down low. But at last there's a groan as he falls to the ground. He arises again and gives one look around. He calls on a comrade, a lad true and trying, say, I'll command you no more, I am shot in the side. There you take him out from under the train, as bullets are falling as thickly as hail. The fight is all over, the cart train is in, so try and escape, the youth must begin. He dashes the cabin with bullets around, and scales the high bank as fleet as a hound. And down to the mountains, and outlaw to roam, Sting revenge I will have for my country and home. And God rest you brave Allman, may in heaven you abide, and pray for the youth who fought by your side. In Ballymy Kellygate they are mourning tonight for young Jimmy Bailey, who fell in the fight. The north wind is blowing along the brown glen, where an old woman waits for her gallant bed. Sing, are they all safe? But the news quickly came that the youth with the colour she would never see again.